everybody. Hope y'all are having a great day. Another beautiful day here in Tennessee. I want to let y'all know I shoot a lot of videos at one time. That's why I wear the same shirt a lot. I know I've said that in other videos, but it's true. I try to put, you know, four or five in my queue or something like that, get them edited. That way I don't have to worry about getting one up every day if I don't have time to do it that day or something like that. I've already got some shot. So that's why I'm still wearing the same shirt I wore in another video there a while back. Today we are going to be talking about the Colt Law Enforcement Carbine M4. This is not the way this rifle came. I've done a lot of upgrades on this rifle. So we're gonna get in some of the upgrades I've done, how this rifle shoots, and just talk about it a little bit. So the elephant in the room that's sticking out right off the bat is this big old ACOG that's sitting on top of it, this Trijicon ACOG. I'm not gonna do a review of this ACOG. I'll go over some a little bit about it, but I'll probably actually review the ACOG at a different time. But you can see everybody pretty well knows what a Trijicon ACOG is. I really like this optic. It runs off tritium and a fiber optic here. It is a very, very rugged optic. And this is the military version that does come with the kill flash. That's what it's called, the kill flash up here in the front. It is sitting on a LaRue mount, a QD mount. As you can see right here, it does have QD levers. It's got two of them. I actually ordered this from LaRue. Just a quick tip for you all that's thinking about ordering optics. If you like LaRue mounts, check their website. A lot of times you can get the optic with the mount already on it for just a shade more than you can buy the optic somewhere else. I mean, it's a lot better deal to do it that way than it is to buy the optic and then go back and try to buy the mount. At least in what I've seen, I've bought several optics from them, and at least that's what I've experienced in whenever I've done that, you know, looked on their website. I'll get that out in a minute. Next, you'll notice this big, long 13-inch Geissele M-Lock rail. This is the only M-Lock rail I own. Me personally, and I know I'm going to get crucified for this in the comments, I prefer Key Mod. I've never had any issues with Key Mod. I don't plan on running my Key Mod rail over my truck. I'm not going to try to use it as a pry bar or something like that. So I know all the arguments on why M-Lock is better because it's tougher, but if, you know, I've never had any issue with Key Mod. I've never had anything come off. And to me, it's easier to put lights and stuff like that on a Key Mod rail than it is an M-Lock rail. That's just my two cents. But in my experience, it's just easier to put accessories on it. You can see up here, I actually just did a review of this light. It is the Surefire Scout Light M600 with the E2 Super Scout Malkoff head on it. This head is 750 lumens when you first turn it on, and it drops down to 700 continuous lumens after that. You can run it on two CR123 batteries or one 16650. That does affect the runtime. Two CR123s is like 15 to 20 minutes constant on, and a 16650 is a like 45 to 60 minutes constant runtime. Now I am running two primary CR123s in this, but you can run a 16650 if you choose to. As you can see, I do run, and I say this in all my video, Troy Industry flip up sights. You cannot flip up the rear sight on the back of this with the ACOG on it, but if something happened to the ACOG, it does have QD mounts, so I can just take that off and then flip up my sights. And like I said, these do lock up. That is why I prefer Troy, and that's why I always use Troy until somebody comes out with something that's better that locks in the up position. As in all my rifles, I do use a Badass Ambi safety, the Battle Arms Development Ambidextrous Safety. They call it the Badass safety. I do use that, as you can see here. And I say this in every single video that I show this safety in. I red Loctite the left-hand side, and I blue Loctite the right-hand side. Blue Loctite you can get apart, so on the right-hand side, let me set this SBR on the ground. On the right-hand side, you can take that off, and you always remove your safety from the left-hand side, so I don't want the left-hand side to be able to come off. If something can happen, it will happen. At the moment, you don't want it to happen. So if I red Loctite the left-hand side and the blue side comes off, I hit it on something or Loctite comes loose, I don't think that would ever happen. But it's not permanent, so anything is possible. the left-hand side will still work as a regular safety. You don't have to worry about that. That's why I read Loctite that side. I say that in every video, and I'll probably continue to say that because that's just a quick tip to get you all to not have a safety go down. Other than that, I am running the stock trigger, mainly because the pins in this rifle are a lot larger than, not a lot larger, but they are larger, than your regular pins in your other rifles. So you have to have a special Geissele trigger for this, and I can't catch them on sale yet to buy them. And I like to buy my Geissele triggers on sale because they're pretty expensive to start with. So this is still running the stock trigger, which is fine. I don't have a problem with that, but I do prefer Geissele triggers. I am still running the stock mag release and the bolt release. Those are all stock. I don't have an issue with those. So I do run those on this rifle. You can see here, this is the Troy Industries Ambi QD sling mount. This is my preferred way to mount a sling on these guns. And you can also see that up here in the front right here and right here, there are sling mounts on either side of this rail. So you can run a 2-point sling with no issues at all. There's also a sling mount on this side of the stock. So if you want to run your sling across the stock and mount it right here, you can also do that. So there's several sling options for this rifle and configuration. So if you're left or right-handed, this one in the back here can be swapped to the other side. So if you're left or right-handed, there's numerous sling options that you can run on this. One more thing about the light, you can see a tape switch up here on top. I said in another video, I normally run a tape switch on my lights, but I did some swapping of some lights and run out of tail caps, and tail caps aren't cheap for surefires. So I need to buy me a couple more of those and at least one more tape switch, maybe two. This one's getting a little wore, so I might actually order two more tape switches. And I'm gonna get some Cloud defensive tape switch mounts. I've got one of those, I've got a video on it. And I love those mounts. I actually thought I had on this one, but it's on my Noveski. That's one of the ones I switched, because that's probably the pistol that I'll have with me if something does happen. So I've fixed it up, you know, top notch. So if I needed it, it was gonna run flawlessly, or should. It's anything human made. But I wanted to go back and show I do use tape switches on the top. I always run them on top. That way when you do your C-clamp, you actually have your finger on that. So this is the M4. It does have the M4 profile barrel. I don't know if you can see that in there, maybe, but this did have the short handguard on it, the carbine length handguard, because it has a carbine gas system. But what I do with my gas systems is I like my gas systems to be staked in. And I think you might be able to see how that's staked in there. Yeah, right there and right there. So what I do is I actually cut off the A2 sight. There's no gas runs through the top of it, so I cut that off and round it over and smooth it out. And there's a company right down the road from me, and they do refinishing, and I have them re-parkerize the gas block after I get done cutting it off, and then I put it back on and drive the pins back through, and that way I've still got the stock gas block on it and I can put a longer rail on it. There's videos on YouTube showing how to do that. I don't have anything right now to show you how to do that. If I get a rifle in the future that I want to do that to again, I will definitely make a video on it. But at this moment, all mine's been cut off and rails have been put on, so I don't have anything that I can show you how to do that. That's just how I prefer to do it. Some people use the ones that screw on from the bottom or clamp on, and that's fine if you don't have any issues with them, but I really prefer mine to be staked, and that's why I do that. But as you can see, this is a Geissele rail. This is a super modular rail, MK8, with a 13-inch length. You can see right there, Geissele. I like this rail all right. Like I said before, I do prefer Key Mod over M-Lock. The only thing I have against this rail is there are some sharp edges on it. I know that's not a big deal. Really and truly, it's really not a big deal. But if they would have rounded that off a little bit, I would have liked that a little bit better. Will it affect how the rifle shoots? Will it affect how I hold it? Not really. But sometimes you can grab it and that'll dig into your hand and it would just be more comfortable. Now, y'all can call me a sissy or whatever you want to, but you know it's true. If something digs in your hand, you could always make it more comfortable. I'm just saying, and that goes for everybody. So I do have an AAC suppressor mount flash hider slash compensator up here. It's a kind of a little mixture of both, you know, a jack of all trades, a master of none kind of thing. This was going to be the suppressor I went with. I don't have a 223 suppressor yet. I plan on getting one, but this was going to be the suppressor I decided to go with. But then I decided if I decide to get a suppressor, it'll probably be a Surefire, like a SOCOM or something like that. So if I do that, I'm not going to take this off till then, but if I do that, I'll wind up taking this off and putting a Surefire brake on this rifle, as well as the same one as I have on my Bravo Company rifle. The stock on this rifle is it's a Magpul STR. You push this button right here, it drops the lock down and you can slide it out. This does still have the stock Colt mil-spec buffer tube, which means it only has four locking positions, and that is it. When you get to the position you want, you push this up and that locks it in place, and it takes some of the wobble out of it. It's fairly tight. There is still just a little bit in it, but that does lock it down pretty good. It does have storage in it right here, so you can actually take these little rubber plates out here, and you have storage down in there. You can store batteries in there, whatever you want, firing pins. And this is fairly water resistant. I ain't gonna say it's waterproof. I've never dunked this rifle, so I don't know. But I think it is fairly water resistant. I keep batteries in there. I keep a few CR123s in there for my light, and that's where I store those. Just know that does add a little weight when you do that. Grip of choice, as a lot of you know, especially if you follow me on Instagram, is the Ergo Grip. I put these on all my rifles. As I say before, the lowers of all my rifles are set up all the same. That way when I pick one up, I don't have to relearn it or wonder which rifle I've got in my hand. They're all the same and they all work the same. So it's all, you know, muscle memory, and everything works perfectly from rifle to rifle. Now on this one, I do have a Mod 4, I believe it is. Yes, it is a Mod 4 Bravo Company charging handle. As you can see right there, it does have the longer tang to grab a hold of to rack the slide. I do like these. I do like the Raptor charging handles, the Radiant Arms, a little better. I do have one right here. As you can see, it's an ambidextrous. I do like these a little better, but I don't have enough of those for every rifle yet. I have them on quite a few of my rifles and pistols, but I don't have enough for every one. So this one got the Bravo Company, which this is an excellent charging handle. And I do have some Bravo Companies that are actually ambidextrous, and I like them as well. But Radiant is actually my favorite one to date. That could change, but to date, that's it. My favorite vert grip is the Troy Industries vert grip. This is an aluminum vertical grip. It is very rounded edges. It's very smooth. It's very comfortable to hold and C-clamp. That's why I like this. I've tried numerous vert grips, and I've never found anything that is as comfortable as this aluminum Troy. These aren't cheap. If you go on eBay, you can find them reasonable. I found one on eBay. I can't remember if it's the one on this SBR or if it's the one I put on my Tavor X95, but I found it and it was almost half price and it was almost brand new. And what happened was the guy in California couldn't have it on his rifle anymore, and he just got it, took it back off his rifle and decided to sell it. And like I said, it was basically brand new in the box, and I gave right at half price for it. So if you look on eBay and stuff, you can find these pretty reasonable. That's your quick tip of the day. Other than that, everything's pretty much stock. I still have the stock Colt barrel, as you can see right there. I've probably put close to, 800 to 1,000 rounds through this rifle with no hiccups. Colt makes a really good gun. I do keep my guns clean, which is probably why I don't have any hiccups. If I shoot 400 or 500 rounds through it, I'll come home and clean it, go shoot another 300 or 400 rounds, come home and clean it. So, you know, I've never just put 1,000 rounds through it and not cleaned it. But, you know, to me, that's kind of abusing it a little bit, because, I mean, I know people do that and don't have any issues, but you should always clean your firearms, because you may have to defend your life with them one day. As you can see here, this one does have some few nicks on the metal, which ain't no big deal. It just adds character. It's not a huge deal. I don't worry about getting nicks and stuff like that on my rifles very much. I've been meaning to spray paint one, and it's probably gonna be my Bravo Company. When I decide to do that, I'll make a video of me ultimately fail in painting my rifle, because I'm sure it won't come out good, because it'll be the first one I've ever done. So we might as well do it on the most expensive one I got, right? So that's pretty much the review of this rifle. You can see right there, it is Colt law enforcement. And actually the old ones even said restricted on this side. That don't mean anything. Anybody can own this, not a big deal. But they did put those on there. That's pretty much the whole thing. It does have a Colt, the factory Colt mil-spec bolt carrier group. Like I said, everything inside this gun is all bone stock. Buffer tube, buffer spring, buffer is all Colt stock stuff from the factory. It does have an Arisaka mount. These are my favorite mounts. They do make them for Key Mod or M-Lock, so that is my favorite mount. And that's just what I run on most of my rifles, if I can, if they have a place I can run it like that. So that's my review of this rifle. I do like it. It runs well, it shoots good, it's very accurate. And I do like the ACOG. I like the aim points a little better for AR style rifles, but I wanted to try an ACOG and I've not regretted it. But in my opinion, I would probably still go with an aim point. If you like this video, please like, share, and subscribe. Give it a big thumbs up. We'll see you next time.